So first thing is, I just wanted to ask a few questions on some more difficult cases. But before we get into that, I wanted to let you know how much listening to your gut has helped me and my how I can help others, and also how to come up with other natural remedies. Because you're really the only one who's even give people hope around fistures and strictures and setons and all these really difficult situations that you can't just do a microbiome change for or take a simple supplement. It's really difficult stuff.
Yeah.
And, the more I've been doing this, the more I've been getting calls from people with very serious, serious situations. And I kind of look at them like, I didn't have that. I'm not really sure. I'll work with you. If you have nowhere else to go, I'm not going to turn you away. But usually we're going through listening to your gut and reading your blogs and looking at your protocols to try to get that root cause issue solved.
Yeah.
So it's really amazing what you've built.
Well, the great thing about it is that my readers are so communicative. Mm-hmm. So for a lot of the new protocols, like dealing with scar tissue, I was able to just say to people, okay, I've got this protocol. It's completely experimental. Like, we have no idea. I test everything on myself first, but I'm like you. I don't have this problem. So yeah. I don't have Crohn's anymore. So I'm a really bad tester now. So I go, I've tested it just to make sure that nothing pops or nothing's like overtly dangerous about it. But who wants to test it? And then I get like 500 people coming in. I've got a little opt-in box if they want to get the ebook protocol, and they go away and they test it, and then we do a survey and we go, okay, what happened? How did it work for you? What could you do? What couldn't you do? Because the theory and then the implementation are often really different, because people have an idea and then they start and whatever, life intervenes, or they realize that, oh, I don't actually have the time to dedicate to this that I wanted. There's tons of reasons why people don't follow a protocol properly. Mm-hmm. So when we survey, we're trying to screen for that too, instead of going, did it work for you or did it not? That type of approach. But because I've got this really communicative readership, I can do basically like trials, mm-hmm. just with like no backer, no pharmaceutical, no funding, no, just say, throw it out there, try it, and mm-hmm. then let's talk about what happened. So mm-hmm. we've got a number of protocols that have, well, the wild oregano oil protocol, which is like now the gold standard for eradicating gut infection. That's mm-hmm. how that developed too, is that mm-hmm. I tested it and then threw it out there and got tons of feedback. And that's how we learned we absolutely have to add the probiotics at bedtime for this protocol to work, because so many people, if you just take that wild oregano, it's too harsh, and it's too the gut then can move into a state of irritation. But mm-hmm. taking that high dose nature and probiotic at night is what calmed everything down, put enough good bacteria in there to start killing stuff again the next day. So stuff like that, which is just a vital part of developing something that has the highest efficacy, but you can't get that if you don't have that feedback from hundreds of people who are in a flare or who are in active bleeding or active inflammation or whatever they've got. So that's pretty cool.
That's priceless. Priceless to have that type of people who you can trust are going to take the right steps, are going to communicate the right way, and already have experience with your other protocols, so you can trust a lot of their judgment on what they say is and isn't. So that's absolutely huge. I had a few questions about one about strictures. So I had a young boy who was around 19 or 9 years old, and he had a stricture come up about a year ago. And his parents ended up getting it removed because that's what the doctor told him to do. So he goes in, it's in his ileum, and the doctors say, we need to remove it, removes the stricture. And then a few months later, the doctor says, oh, there's another one almost directly at the same spot as where the first one came, and we need to have another surgery on this 9-year-old boy who's underweight, malnourished, anemic. So it's long story short, we've been working together for a while, and we started doing the topical and internal stricture healing protocol with the DMSO, starting off with just 1/8 a teaspoon of DMSO, and was able to taste it and had a little dry skin irritation, common symptoms responses. But with those type of stricture heal issues, is there anything you recommend to try to, with a kid to get kind of grow that faith on what they can do? How long they should do the stricture heal protocol? How to know if the stricture is really seeing a reduction in the size or.
And this is probably the issue for anybody, regardless of age. So first of all, let's talk about the irritation. If you're getting irritation, you can put the castor oil on, put a thin layer of castor oil on first, and then put the DMSO, because it's okay if the DMSO drives the castor oil into the tissues. That's actually beneficial.
Yeah.
And then after the protocol, if he can get some comfrey salve. So the herb comfrey is the most fantastic wound healer you'll ever try. So, and just check my shop for brands that I recommend. Those are ones that have, a high potency comfrey instead of a lot of base and a little bit of comfrey sprinkled in.
Yeah. So
put that over the area wherever there's irritation after the treatment, and that'll just take
topically.
Care of it. Topically, yeah.
Okay, fantastic. Yeah. And I have used the comfrey root as part of an enema protocol, which has seemed to help a lot.
Yes, exactly.
I've worked with a few kids. This kid, I just felt like was in a very serious situation. His parents don't have much natural medicine background. He's on a very clean diet, using Absorb Plus, semi-elemental, very specific what he's eating, but he's 9 years old and he wants to eat gummy bears and all those sorts of things.
Yeah.
And there's not a really clear way of seeing where the stricture is. We're doing a delayed food allergy test now. We just did a comprehensive stool test.
Yeah.
And it showed that he has some dysbiosis and a parasite as well. So we're treating that and using the wild oregano, of course, with the stricture heal, which has the double, is beneficial for the microbial issues as well.
Yeah. And we had a medical doctor, and his daughter went swimming in some river in South America somewhere, and she picked up a parasite and he tried, he did. And on my blog, I've called it quad synergy parasite protocol, because this is like super strong one, but it's basically stricture heal combined with wild oregano oil. And she had colitis at the time, so I didn't know if it would be too strong for people or whatever, but he reported back and he said no, it was awesome and it cleared it and she was totally fine. So we do have a reliable tester who has access to testing facilities, who's confirmed that for us. The thing with the oral DMSO protocol as part of the stricture heal, again, that's a way where you've just got to try to do what you can do. And we've had some people who didn't do the oral protocol and just did the topical and experienced enough relief that their stricture didn't bother them anymore. And sometimes they'd have to be, careful with their diet during times of stress or whatever. They didn't have a colonoscopy to confirm the dissolution of the scar tissue, because, then you're back at the beginning. But really it's just about function. It's about, can you eat? Can you get through life? So, even if the little guy can't take the oral anymore, there's definitely enough feedback to keep going with the topical component.
Okay.
And then a lot of people too, like we had one guy and his wife just could not take the smell of him when he was taking the DMSO orally. She was just like, I'm not even sleeping in the same room with you. So it was really stressful for him to do that protocol. Mm-hmm. So, you know, that's where you've got to kind of just work it in with your lifestyle and how, and really, and, but for me, I'm like, okay, not sleeping with my wife, surgery. I'd be like, that's not a problem. I don't have a problem with that. Like, if your marriage can't handle that, I'd be looking at the marriage personally, but anyway. Right. So you just kind of, but some people cycle on and off it, right? They go like, okay, I just can't take this anymore. So I'm going off the oral, but I'm going to continue with the topical. Okay. And then when they feel able, they come back on.
Okay.
So,
and so two questions about that. The DMSO oral, how often, if someone's really saying, I really want to commit to this, and you got, you know, for this example, because I'm working with a 9-year-old kid who has this issue, when is enough, meaning if he does the internal and topical right now, let's say topical once at night before bed and internal, that, you know, could we do that 1/4 a teaspoon twice a day? Would that be too much with the aloe vera and the potassium?
Oh, I don't think that would be too much. No.
Okay.
I'm trying to remember when I tested it, how often I did it. I think I did it 2 and possibly 3 times a day.
Mm, okay. Yeah. And I've been kind of just playing with it where, you know, just doing 1/8 a teaspoon once a day and see how he does. And he did get the taste of it, and he's young, and I just wanted to make sure he did okay.
Yeah.
But we were working up just to get him to 1/4 a teaspoon once a day and see how
what's he mixing it in?
Apple juice.
Yeah. That's good.
Yeah. Organic apple juice. So, but he seems to be doing pretty well with it. Hasn't gained any weight, but hasn't had many issues, and hasn't been throwing up. So one of the biggest symptoms he had was he was always throwing up and more or less constipated with normal bowel movements.
Hmm.
So never had any serious blood or diuretic issues, mucus, any of that. Normal bowel movements, more prone to constipation, but anemic and underweight.
Hmm. And so, he's had his, well, I guess they couldn't check him for rectal spasm, could they? Because that doesn't show up on any digital exam or rectal exam. But the what could be causing, if his stool are normal, but he can't, you know, get the poo out, he could be experiencing rectal spasm where the rectum just kind of clamps shut.
Yeah.
And so then you look at magnesium.
Magnesium citrate.
Magnesium and potassium, but you don't want to, well, this is where we move to the atomic sized, the nano minerals, right? Yeah. Because if you give the powdered, the kid's probably going to have diarrhea.
Yeah.
Because especially with someone with IBD, they're really sensitive to magnesium. So you do the atom. And the reason I say atom sized is I've done a lot of research on this. I think that's the most accurate term because, you know, people are saying, well, we break these minerals down into the most microscopic particle and they're, you know, tinier than the size of an atom. And I'm like, okay, wait a minute. We have magnesium, right? Mg.
Yeah. It's
like if you break magnesium apart, you no longer have magnesium. So how can you be saying that you're, so there's a ton of misinformation of people who just haven't even looked at the basic science. So the smallest unit that you can break magnesium down to is the magnesium atom.
Okay.
And yes, that is nano-sized. It is picometer sized, but it is the Mg atom. So I like atom sized. That's the word I'm using now because it's like you can't break it smaller than an atom because then it's not magnesium anymore.
Yeah.
It's something else, right?
Yeah.
So anyway, that's what I recommend is get the magnesium and the potassium in the atom-sized minerals, which are just in water. They're really easy to take. And then also he may need to, when he's pushing to have a bowel movement, if he feels the area right around the anus, right? On either side of it and possibly in front of it, if that tissue is rock hard or really hard, it means he's in rectal spasm. Okay. So what happens is it goes into that spasm, it goes into that cramp, and the cramp itself feels like a stool, so it makes you push harder, but it's not. It's just the muscle that has gone solid. Right? So if he feels that, what he does is, you know, he's using a squatty, he's got his hips higher than his knees, higher than his hips, so in the squat position, And he uses his fingers, or his mom can do this. I don't know what their relationship is, but maybe his mom can do this for him, to reach around the back of the toilet and just massage the tissue, just kind of push it to get it. And you'll feel it. When that spasm goes away, it goes completely soft. That okay. tissue just softens right up.
And then,
yeah. And I have a video. I have the constipation pooping positions, the first one, and then I have the second one, and it also has rectal prolapse. So get the mom to watch both videos, actually, because they'll give her positions for him to use. Because sometimes when you put too much downward pressure on that rectum, that can cause it to go into spasm, especially okay. if they have a magnesium potassium deficiency, which is basically nature's muscle relaxants, right?
Okay, fantastic. That's great. That's great information. And the one thing about the wild oregano, do you find that that's usually strong enough to kill a variety of parasites and dysbiosis bacteria? Or do you feel like they usually need to put it with something like berberine or maybe something like monolaurin for viral or streptococcus?
I would, because it's not been tested, I would combine it.
Yeah, that's what I've been doing. I've been combining great results with other herbal. But, you know, wild oregano, we usually only want to stay in that for about 3-4 weeks on, then 3-4 weeks off.
Well, you know what? You can go off back when I developed the protocol, you can go off for as little as a week or 10 days and then go back on.
Okay. As long as you're using good beneficial bacteria too, just to
support. Yes. When you're off, you are high dose on the bacteria.
Okay. Yeah. When you're off, you're high dose. Okay.
Yeah. Very good point.
Do you ever see a value for doing more than 1 teaspoon of each strain twice a day? I mean, that seems like a pretty large dose.
A lot of people are doing that 3 times a day.
Okay.
And some people combine that with the probiotic retention enema.
Okay. Yep.
So it just, again, you link to your own body. For a child, you've really got to be sensitive. They have to make their own decisions. They have to say yes. You know, the child needs to be taught how to listen to their own body, how to put their hand on their belly and ask their belly. Mm-hmm. Because if the child can be empowered and be in charge, that changes everything.
Mm-hmm.
Right. And another great way to get a child on board is to do guided visualizations with them.
Yep.
You know, and there's audio recordings for that. There's also special like therapists that they can take the child to, who will walk, and mom can stay in the office and they'll walk them through a guided visualization. And it's really empowering when kids can understand how to use their imagination to engage the healing process. So I would almost say, if you're working with a child, I would put that at number one on the list. Because if you think about it, psychologically and energetically, if the child is hating everything you're doing, you're cutting your success by at least 50, 75%.
Yeah.
Just because if you don't want to heal, you're not going to heal. It's your body.
Yeah.
Right? That mind, body, spirit have to be in alignment. So there's no point in forcing a child to do this and bullying them to do that and bribing them to do this, because if they're not fully receiving that healing into their cells and tissues, right? It's a waste of time.
Yeah, I agree. It's hard. He's young. He just wants to play, you know, his college games, and he is seeming to do better, and he's had less responses and more energy. So we're going to keep moving along. His stool test showed he did have some issues in there that we're going to continue to treat and retest here in the next few weeks, which will tell us if we're in the right direction. And I think they've been pretty good about the stricture heal. So I think that's a really good information for him. I'll talk to his parents about. And about the probiotics, how do you feel about Saccharomyces boulardii and colostrum? Do you feel like they're good additives with nature and probiotics?
I think colostrum definitely, if the person tolerates dairy, right? And then you want to make sure you get it from a really pristine source, right?
Yeah. I've been using grass-fed, A1, not having A1 beta casein and being Swedish cows.
Yeah, perfect. You know, what I'd really like to see with colostrum and actually all dairy products, I'd like to see humane dairy come into existence where the calves are left with the mothers for ideally 6 months, but at least four. Because if you think about it, like why, like personally, I would, the idea that I am taking substances to benefit my body, that a mother has had her baby ripped from her at birth to provide me, is mm-hmm. really immoral and energetically horrible.
Yeah.
So I think we need to start talking about this and bringing this out into public discussion to go, you know, the vegan is one thing where they go, we don't touch dairy, but you know, humans have been consuming dairy for millennia. I don't think that's going to change, you know, maybe never, maybe not for 20, 30 years. But what we can start asking for is humane dairy,
yeah,
right? The 100%. Calves and there's a dairy in England and there's another one in the US. Again, I've got a blog post on this where mm-hmm. they leave the calves with the mothers sometimes until they're adults because, and it's not a problem. The cow just produces more milk and the cows come down to the milking barn of their own accord. They come down from the pasture. The calves wait outside the barn and the mom goes into her station, gets hooked up, gets milk, comes back out, calf joins her and they hop back out to the pasture again. It's so incredible compared to mother gives birth, farmer comes in, takes away the calf and mother cries for five days, 10 days, whatever it is. And then that cow that has a normal lifespan of 25 years is dead in 5 years from heartbreak. Cause you can't do that. You can't give birth and have your baby taken away from you the second it hits the ground. Like it's horrible, right?
It is horrible.
Colostrum is again like, okay, so how can we harvest colostrum that leaves enough for the calf?
Yeah.
Right. So that's a part of humane colostrum, humane dairy. And I just wanted to throw that out there. If all of us as consumers can start having a consciousness about that.
Yeah.
And
huge point.
Spreading the word, right?
Yeah. Amen. Amen to that. Huge point. What about Saccharomyces boulardii? Do you like using that in conjunction?
I don't like using it long term. Way back when I had a naturopath, he was the head of the Canadian Naturopathic Association, and mm-hmm. he really didn't like using it. He said, it's a yeast. He said, so it's okay for a really short term or, you know, like a intervention, but to take it ongoing or to keep putting that. And I kind of went, and I tested it. Mm-hmm. And my body just didn't like it very much. So for me, I was like, okay, I'm done with that substance.
Yeah, yeah. I did see that it had some benefits for traveler's diarrhea or fighting off E. coli.
Yeah.
I've seen some benefits, but short term, like you were saying,
yeah.
Completely agree there. You know, I have multiple clients who have fistulas and it's really hard to heal. I mean, really the only thing I'm seeing that we're doing is predominantly elemental with some meals, maybe midday when they can use them and just try to give them some stability. And then using either fissure heal or a comfrey root enema to try to get a healing effect. But I'm wondering what your thoughts are on people who are dealing with those kind of chronic fistulas. And then kind of a footnote onto that question is also those who have a seton. I have one client who has a constipation, has had a fistula for about 6 years and had a seton for about 2 years straight.
Yeah.
And I've never had one. I never had a serious fistula as well. So it's kind of new to me. And I'm not sure if you had a lot of experience working with some clients with similar issues.
Yeah, I, like you, never did have a fistula. And I have actually, again, a medical doctor who had said that he thinks the fistulas are caused by the drugs. He said, he took a look at the research and he said, if you just leave someone with Crohn's alone and you don't give them any medication, I'm not sure if there's no incidence of fistulas or it's just incredibly low.
Incredibly low. Wow.
Yeah. So he was like, this is actually a side effect of the drugs. So I thought, wow, that's really interesting.
That's interesting. Yeah.
Yeah. But, okay. So first of all, if there is a fistula, it means there's infection present.
Okay.
So don't use comfrey. Don't okay. use any kind of wound healing, because if you somehow manage to heal over that tissue, you're going to make the body tunnel an exit drainage hole somewhere else.
Okay.
Yeah. So that's why surgery for GEN is useless, because if you haven't healed the site of infection,
yeah,
it's just going to have to tunnel through and drain somewhere else.
Yeah.
Because this is what people need to understand, is we're getting back to the body's wisdom. You have infection in a deep structure of the body. Mm-hmm. So it's not like the skin where your body can just open up a hole and drain it, right? And mm-hmm. it can't get rid of it through trapping it in mucus and coughing it out, or trapping it in mucus and passing it through the bowel, or vomiting, or any of the other methods of expulsion. Mm-hmm. So the body in its wisdom says, if we don't start pushing this infection out of the body, we are going to go into sepsis and then we'll be dead. So instead of going, why can't I get rid of this fistula? Like, to just understand the psychology behind that, right? That this is your body keeping you alive. So until you heal that infection where it's happening, you don't want to close that fistula. You want to keep it open. You want to keep it draining.
Wow. So that's the body's ability, natural ability to protect itself, by draining an infection that's literally festering more and more and more. And if we were to cut that out or try to heal it, it would have to create another place where it would fester in a different part of the body to try to drain it.
Yeah, which is why the body will tunnel through bone. People have those come out in their out through their tailbone.
Wow.
The body will tunnel through whatever it needs to go to drain that, because once it hits your blood, if you get infection in your bloodstream, which is sepsis, you can die very quickly from that.
Wow. That point needs to kind of sink in for, I think, a lot of people who are dealing with fistulas, that what is the root cause?
Yeah.
And because that's going to give them a little bit more of a North Star.
Yes.
You know, we need to go this way. And I wasn't even completely aware of that. So that's huge information.
And that's a good thing for me to know, because I'm working on the third edition of Listen to Your Gut right now. And I do talk about that. I think I talk about it, though, when I'm talking about wild oregano. I don't have it in the fistula section. So I'm going to go and put it there, and I'm going to add it to my blog post. So thank you.
You're welcome. There we go. See, people helping people. We're all getting through this. What would be a good, if you're dealing with someone who's had a fistula for 6 years, what would be maybe a blueprint that they could use as just a broad idea of how can they start?
What the people on the blog, because I don't know if you've been to the blog, I think there's like 250 comments of people who've tried it and they're giving their feedback. Uh-huh. So what seems to be the most effective is to do an internal pathogen anti-infection protocol, right? Okay. So that's either the wild oregano, or the wild oregano mixed with the DMSO and the silver, and, you know, whichever works or is appropriate for that person.
Okay.
And then to use that fistula drainage hole as the access point to the infection. Because again, for a systemic antibiotic, whether it's drug or natural, it's really difficult to get it into, you know, a tissue that's buried somewhere through several structures, right? Like that can take a long time. So your fistula, again, is brilliant, because it's dug you an access tube to the site of the infection.
Wow.
So what you do is you get those long dental syringes, right?
Okay.
They're long and they're very thin. And this is where if someone has a seton, it's really helpful, because you can just put the syringe up the seton and just like really power drive the plunger to shoot it up as far as you can.
Uh-huh.
And so that's your mixture of either wild oregano oil, or again, we have people who've experimented. People are saying that's not working. So I've been like, okay, try this. Let's put the DMSO in there. Let's put the silver in there.
Yeah.
And those formulas are on my blog post as well.
Fantastic.
And so people have been syringing those, because you basically want to get it as close to the site as you can. Now, as soon as you eradicate the infection, the body will start healing the tissue.
The fistula will close up naturally. So that's when you know it's good, is when it naturally starts to heal.
It'll naturally start to heal, and your fistula tract is this long, and it'll start healing from this end. It won't start healing from the outside end. So it starts healing, and then you'll be like, oh my gosh, I can't put the syringe up so far. Yeah, because your body's healing the tissue.
Wow.
And then the great thing about adding DMSO to that is you know you've got a little bit of scar tissue control happening there. So it's helping it to be a more supple tissue that it's healing with. Mm-hmm. And then when it gets close to the surface, that's when you can do your comfrey and whatever to just heal the last bit.
The last bit when you feel like it's really gone. That's huge. And how does the DMSO help to heal? Does the DMSO have those type of antimicrobial properties?
This is the amazing thing about DMSO is nobody knows.
Yeah, I was reading about it. But I think one of the quotes was something like, it is the replacement of water. It is the...
It binds to water molecules faster than water. So, which is why you can put some on the sole of your foot and taste it on your tongue within a millisecond. It just goes, because the body's 90% water, 95, whatever it is.
So if you mix DMSO with water regularly, it might actually be able to absorb into the body more effectively, making it a portal or a transport vehicle.
Yes, exactly. Wild oregano. It binds with the wild oregano and it drives it into the tissues because it also will hook up with the water in the tissues and it just penetrates right through. So it's... Yeah, I mean, the drug companies are going to, well, they've already banned it. I mean, that's why we can't actually mix anything together. We have to just sell it in the glass bottles for use as a solvent only on the outside because there's only one drug. It's a drug for a urinary infection. I think it's an interstitial infection. Anyway, a drug company has the patent on it. Mm-hmm. So they can use DMSO, but nobody else can.
Oh my God, we need a revolution.
Yeah. But the actual healing action, nobody knows. Dr. Stanley Jacobs at, University of Oregon, somewhere in Oregon, he's the one who's been researching it for like 20 or 30 years. Mm-hmm. Its mechanism of action is still unknown. It's just like this next level substance and we don't know how it does everything it does. But we do know, and Olympic athletes and professional athletes like football players and stuff, they've been using it for decades because it cuts the injury healing time. Like if you put it on topically, and then if you really want to increase the topical, you put it on topically and then you wrap it. So you like seal it with, you know, maybe a layer of cotton and then saran wrap over top. Mm-hmm. And it just... like an athlete can heal in a quarter of the time it would normally take them to heal.
Really? Like an ACL tear or a shoulder tear issue?
Yes.
Like muscle, skeletal frame.
Everything.
And would you always recommend putting a bit of castor oil on beforehand just to give it a little bit of, to help with any kind of dryness or, you know?
I like to because, you know, once you've irritated the skin, it's going to be harder for you to reapply.
Yep.
So I do like to put a thin layer of, you know, just a thin layer of the castor and then the DMSO. And then you can put more after the DMSO has soaked in for a bit, you know, like 15 or 20 minutes, you can apply more castor oil on top to also help soothe it.
Okay.
But castor oil is a substance that, again, we don't really know how that works, but we do know that it relieves muscle pain and it relieves cramping and it increases microcirculation. And so again, that's a substance we totally want the DMSO to bind with and drive into the tissues. And the only caveat for what DMSO will not bind with is if the substance has a higher molecular weight than the DMSO itself. So yeah, when I first developed the protocol, I was like, what's the molecular weight of wild oregano? That took me a while to find.
Who knows that? How do I even find that out?
Yeah, exactly. You got to be Google expert on that stuff.
So if, for everyone out there who might be listening or to simplify this, they can use for a fistula, they could use DMSO, obviously trying in very small doses, work with a practitioner, talk to the doctor, consult about it first. But they can use that with the wild oregano. And with the people you've seen use this protocol, how often till they can, you've seen people get results, you know, a time frame, and how long should they keep doing it for before they feel like if it's they can judge if it's successful?
I would think, I think you'd see some positive results within 3 weeks.
Okay. Once a day, twice a day?
Twice a day for sure.
Okay.
Up to three times a day if it feels good to you. But I would do twice a day, definitely.
Yep.
Although we've had people who could only do it once a day and they've had good results.
The body just responds. It starts herxing or they start to get up. Your body's, it's killing. I mean, you know, absolutely had people like that too. But just, you know, some people, I give them wild oregano, three drops, they're on the toilet, they're tired, brain fog, yep, massive herxing. Other people have serious parasite issues and dysbiosis, and they can just take a whole thing and nothing.
Exactly.
You know?
Which is exactly. And thank you for bringing that out of just with everything to start really low and start really slow. Because as we know, if you've got IBD or you've got IBS, your body is hypersensitive already. Yep. So you have to bring that sense of regard and care to your body with whatever you're doing with it. You have to say, okay, let's try this. Let's test it. Let's see how it goes. And also, as you said, when using DMSO, you need to have some guidance because, you know, any substance that's super potent, you can really do some damage with it too.
Yeah.
So they need to have gotten my ebook on it or be working with someone like you, because there's a lot of safety considerations that we're not talking about here. And I don't think we need to, because I don't want people to just hear one video on it and go out and start using this stuff. I want them to take the time to educate themselves properly.
Yeah.
But, you know, to make sure that people are understanding that, don't just go out and grab. There's even, you know, parameters, like if you're buying your DMSO in a plastic bottle, touch it, right?
Yep.
If this thing binds to everything, what do you think it's doing to all the, like, I don't even know how many toxins are in plastic. And then you want to put that into your tissues?
Exactly.
Really bad idea.
I couldn't agree more. Everyone should be, you know, check out Jeannie's ebook on DMSO and fissure heal, stricture healing. It's right on our website. It's very affordable. It's an easy read, and that'll give you a baseline. Try to be working with someone who has experience using it, whether it's a licensed practitioner or a coach of some sort. Absolutely needed. I completely agree.
I think as well, Dane, I think I've got those ebooks available free on my blog. So just do search. Just do a search for DMSO on my blog, and it'll pull up all the posts. And Hemorrh Heal, that's the other thing we've been using it with, is for hemorrhoids, both internal and external. And those are like super, super effective.
The DMSO, wait, the Hemorrh Heal or the DMSO with the Hemorrh Heal?
The Hemorrh Heal is a formula that contains DMSO.
Okay, contains
DMSO. Yep. So the topical, like if you have external hemorrhoids, we've got, like, normally people are healed in 7 to 10 days. It's crazy.
Wow. I have clients who cannot get rid of their hemorrhoids.
I know. And internal hemorrhoids, because those just keep popping and bleeding and popping and bleeding. Those can be healed in 2 weeks. It's just, I mean, 2 weeks at the fastest, but, you know, definitely. And then again, there's a very similar formula that you use for strictures in the rectum. Right? Okay. Because anybody who's had any kind of rectal surgery or even a lot of the exploratory procedures can tear the tissue of the rectum. And then when the rectum heals, it puts a layer of scar tissue. Now you've got, like, your client, his bowel movements are normal and he's constipated. Well, is he, or is there a stricture there? Is there rectal spasm happening? Is there, you know,
that's a great point. And that, the Hemorrh Heal, you know, this kind of leads into the last client I wanted to talk about. This girl is, I just got to mention her because she's such a trooper. She came to me at 21 years old, 21, 22, and had severe IBD. Doctors were talking about doing surgery on her. She was out of college, living at home, chronic bleeding and signs of rheumatoid arthritis, chronic inflammation and pain in her hips and joints. We've been working together for about 5 months, and she was basically symptom free for 4 of those months. I mean, within the first month, we put her on antimicrobial, a strong probiotic regimen, a strong supplement additive, and she just did so well with it, very consistent. So she went into the doctor, and the doctor said, well, let's take a look. Blood work looks good. You know, still some iron issues, still calprotectin inflammation, which I'd love to hear about your thoughts on calprotectin. But she gets a sigmoidoscopy. And they said, well, go in. Everything's actually looking great. You got a great, huge reduction in symptoms. Whatever you're doing, keep doing it. High fives all around. But all of a sudden, a few days later, she starts getting blood in the stool. And now she's had chronic on and off blood in the stool for the last 3 weeks since the colonoscopy. And I just wanted to get your thoughts, because I've talked to a lot of my clients when they're healing. They said, okay, I'm going to get the colonoscopy now because I really want that check mark. And I'm like, listen, you know, look at what a colonoscopy is. Understand that it can actually increase your risk of colon cancer. Understand that it can increase your risk of having an inflammatory response, and that they can't properly clean these things that they're using sometimes up to 60 times a day on different clients or different people coming in. So would love to get your ideas on, you know, one, what could someone like that do who's doing so well now getting the blood, is using Fissure Heal, but is not, that doesn't seem to be helping as much. We were going to use the comfrey root enema, but you guys have been out for a little bit.
Yeah, we just found, because we're very stringent on suppliers.
Yeah.
So we have found another supplier. I think it may even be in stock now. But you know, she's going to have to go back to the beginning and start all over again. You know, like when she came to you.
Yep.
She's there or worse, because that's what a colonoscopy does. And I came up with that, my report on the dangers of colonoscopy, I don't know how many years ago, maybe 10 or 15. Mm-hmm. And then in the last 5 years, there's also some other doctors on the internet who went, wait a minute, and come up with exactly the same, like, and people are going, oh, well, this was so long ago. Nothing's changed. You still cannot, because the fiber optic camera is mm-hmm. so delicate that mm-hmm. anything that could kill the pathogens is going to damage the camera, right? Mm-hmm. You can't put a corrosive acid on a camera lens. Your lens will be pocked and pitted and you won't be able to see anything. Mm. So this just, until they develop, the only way you're going to know that a colonoscopy is not going to carry a risk of infection is if they have a disposable sheath that covers the entire tube.
A condom for the colonoscopy.
Exactly. And they have those for sigmoidoscopies, mm-hmm. and they also have disposable sigmoidoscopies now. So unless you've got a sheath or a disposable colonoscope, mm-hmm. forget it. I would not, there's no way. And then, you know, the doctors, when they're using it, if they hit an area of scar tissue or narrowing, they take that tube and they start ramming it. They're like, I remember that from when I've had one colonoscopy in my entire life when I was first diagnosed, and I've never had another one.
Wow.
I think they're like the worst thing that you can do. This is my husband. I'm like, go away. I'm on a call. they're the worst thing that you can do to destroy your gut.
Yeah.
So you just spent like months or years healing yourself. And because like you said, you want the tick box, you want somebody else. You're still looking to give your authority and your power over your body away to somebody else to mm-hmm. say, oh, you're symptom free. You're healed. There's no markers of Crohn's, except tomorrow there will be.
Exactly. Right back where you started. Well, for people out there listening, because I mean, every single client I work with is always talking about going to get that colonoscopy for that check mark. What are, you know, some of the big dangers of colonoscopy? So there's a huge risk of infection. We know that it kills the beneficial bacteria within your gut. It can set off the immune system, especially when they're taking samples, which is creating an open wound.
Yes.
Is there anything else you think that's notable or its effect on risk of colon cancer?
Well, our colon cancer. No, I think you've covered it, right? Like the infective component, the damage to the intestinal walls, and most importantly is the wiping out of that good gut flora. Like if you have IBD, it takes a minimum of 6 months to 2 years to actually switch that intestinal flora to be robustly beneficial.
Yeah.
And so then you're going to go in one procedure and just put yourself back to zero again. Mm-hmm. So now you're looking at a minimum of 6 months of high dose oral and rectal to get, like, why would you do that to yourself? So if you have a strong body wisdom, ask your body for a dream. I always ask for additional points of guidance for something like that. If all of those things are telling you to get a colonoscopy, fine, go get a colonoscopy. But again, in my colonoscopy dangers book or someone like you, there's a protocol to follow before colonoscopy and immediately after to minimize all those points of damage and to help the body, you know, sustain the procedure and recover from it as quickly as possible. So there is things you can do before and after. And if that's your guidance or your gut, or you receive a dream, or, you know, look for places of wisdom that you can access that doesn't come from fear. Mm-hmm. If those places are telling you to have a colonoscopy, then go and have one. You know, the body knows, right? The body knows what it needs. But just to have it as a check, like just do a stool count, do an ultrasound, do, like, there's so many non-invasive, you know, you can get your little boxes ticked on all of those without risking your entire health. And then I would go, and then if you still want to risk your entire health, then you know what that tells me? That tells me that you're healing the physical, but you have not healed the spiritual, emotional roots of your dis-ease. Which is why you're wanting to recreate them. Mm. You're wanting, there's something in your mind, your energy field, that's wanting to put you right back in there. Mm. When you've just done all this work and you've come so far and you've done, why is that not enough for you? Why do you need to go back to zero again? Right? Mm. That's a saboteur, right? And you see this across, this is not just health. I see this in business because I've been working with people, you know, to develop my business program. And I worked with people one-on-one. I worked with 10 testers one-on-one. And I saw there's a certain percentage of people, you can take them, you can give them all the know-how. You can take them to where they've launched their business. They're generating great cash flow and they will just boom, they'll tank that business. They'll let their website expire. They'll lose everything. They'll just, it's unbelievable to me. And so then we're back to the emotional, psychological, spiritual blocks and saboteurs that we use to blow up our lives in whichever form, or relationship, right? I'm sure you've seen people do this in relationship whenever they get with someone who's healthy, right? Yeah. Or they have an opportunity to have a healthy relationship. They just blow it up.
Yeah. Yeah. I think there's a lot of emotional, and I know that EFT is something you like to do to help people with those emotional. So that can be checked out. And so, you know, the colonoscopy, I mean, one thing I think that helped me, I got two or three colonoscopies myself. I got a sigmoidoscopy the second time, and I did see an issue with right afterwards, but doing a probiotic retention enema was very helpful. Doing large doses of antimicrobial in case there was something that got in there was very helpful. More meditation, more sun, high doses of vitamin D, I think really helped me. Yeah. So that was huge. And what about calprotectin? I mean, if you're seeing, one of the ones check marks I tell a lot of clients to look at is if you're getting a comprehensive stool test from something like Genova, I use Diagnostic Solution Labs to test, and you're seeing that there's no dysbiosis, there's no H. pylori, your IgA secretories are healthy, but that's something that can really help you say, look, there's no inflammation in there, it's a healthy microbiome, there's no reason that I need to go any step further. That can be a really great checkbox. But sometimes I'll see people who have almost everything good in that, but their calprotectin levels are high. And anyone who doesn't know what that is, it's just inflammation found in the gut. So C-reactive proteins, inflammation found in the blood, but the calprotectins, the inflammation found in the gut, is still seemingly high. And have you ever noticed any correlations with high calprotectin that just can't seem to get back down to normal, even though they're not seemingly having any delayed food allergies or their microbiome's healthy, no dysbiosis, no parasites? You ever seen anything like that?
That's where I would go back again to the emotional, mental, spiritual, because if you think about inflammation as let's replace it with the word irritation.
Okay.
Right? Because inflammation usually is a sign of infection. mm-hmm. right? It's part of the body's response. Again, the body's wisdom of the tissues inflame, which means that there's a high number of healing helpers that are rushing to the site of infection to deal with the infection and you know, get it out of the system and, you know, the whole process of that. That's usually what inflammation, or like, say, if you have a sports injury, what is inflammation? It's the healing factors in the blood rushing to repair the damage, to start healing the tissue, to, and so what looks like inflammation and swelling is the body's repair system. That's how it repairs it, right? Mm-hmm. So if there's no infection present, but you're still having that type of response, I would look to irritation. I would look to what are the people or events or things in your life that are irritating you, that are inflaming you, that are that something in you is rising up in protest against them, right? So you may be in an unhealthy relationship that you live with, and that person inflames and irritates you on a daily basis because your deeper wisdom knows you got to move on. This person is not healthy, or you have to go for healing together. You have to go for counseling, but you have to change the dynamic because we can't forget that the gut is the first response for emotion in the body. Mm-hmm. You know, like a lot of people go, oh, my heart. And I'm like, no, your gut is responding way before your heart is. Mm-hmm. Right. So it's, and 60% of your neurotransmitters, how you think and feel about things, are in your gut, not even in your brain. Mm. So when we have things like that, we have to go to the emotional, mental, spiritual, mm. you know, maybe you're in a job that is, you know, it's a dead end to nowhere. It's not feeding your soul. It's not giving you an avenue for your passion. It's not allowing you to be your best self. It's like choking off the reason you came here. Mm-hmm. Well, your gut cannot stop messaging you about that. Your body cannot stop messaging you about that mm-hmm. because we're not here to just live a nice little life and uh-huh. earn our money and, uh-huh. and, you know, die at the end of it. That's not why we're here. We're all here for a bigger purpose, whether that purpose is service or learning or exploration or passion or whatever. So when uh-huh. we get out of alignment with that, the gut is one of the first places to show that. And even like my daughter made this connection because of course my kids, you know, when they're teenagers, they're kind of going off and doing their own thing, but they've got a really good base of health that I've given them.
Yeah.
And so she's been getting a lot of breakouts on her skin. And I go, what's your body saying to you? Like, what's that about? She goes, you know, every time I'm really irritated, like everything's pissing me off, my skin breaks out. I go, well, hello, 1 + 1 = 2. Yes, yeah. You're irritated. You're mm. annoyed. You're like, and look what's happened to your skin. Your skin's irritated and annoyed. And like, so it's, and so just giving her that consciousness to go, so instead of making your body speak for you, why don't you start dealing with those roots of like, what are the problems in your life? Right? Yeah. What are the situations? Who do you need to talk to? How do you need to structure things differently?
What experience do you need to have?
Exactly.
And, you know, one thing that helped me with that, because that's a really intangible thing that a lot of people have a hard time grasping onto. It's like grasping.
Oh, yeah.
On one thing that really helped me is I actually went to a breath class, which a lot of people go, what, a breath class? What does that even mean?
Perfect.
And one of the biggest takeaways I wanted to share with anyone out there who's trying to say, what do I do with this information, is when you go through something traumatic in your life, it actually leaves trauma in your body that your cells have. And let's say you can teach yourself. Some people in sales will teach themselves to get in a certain mode when they snap rubber band against their wrist, right? And they practice motivating. Every time they feel that rubber band, they have a response, right? That's a trauma they're creating within them. And when you go through trauma or traumatic events, it leaves trauma in your body that can live with you for the rest of your life.
Yeah.
And so when I started using a breath class, what I love about breath class is you can't analyze it. You can't talk it. You can't even explain it. It's using your gut brain to try to release and purge negative energy. And that's kind of what this is about, where if you're having those stressors, healing that root cause is about having an experience, not just a thought, but an experience that allows a purge.
Yes.
And so anyone who's looking to try to implement some of these more intangible things, I find that doing breath classes, Talking can be an experience, but usually it needs to be on a deeper level and
with yeah.
Or you saying something that you need to get off your chest. That's an experience.
Yeah. But with your breath class, I don't find talking therapy, like psychotherapy and counseling and stuff, are only helpful in that they bring things to your conscious awareness.
Yeah.
But that does not release it from the cells and tissues. Yeah. So maybe use that to bring it to your conscious awareness and then go to breath class.
Yes.
And use the breath to release it, right? Whatever your technique is. So there's any kind of breathing and meditative technique. There's EFT that we talked about, the tapping. There's hypnotherapy. There's somato-emotional level of craniosacral, which is also fantastic. Like anybody who's working with a mind-body interface. So you want the mental awareness, you want to have the consciousness of, like you said, the trauma or the pattern or the belief, but then you need to actually go into the cells and tissues. So whatever therapy you're using, make sure it's accessing and integrating both of those layers, because that's how you actually release it from the body. So it's not stuck there and held there.
Mm. So, one, finding a way to guide towards what could be the potential issue, and then have using one of these three things. Hypnotherapy, I'm actually having one of my first hypnotherapy things Saturday. And everyone listening, you know, I grew up in the suburbs and I worked at Papa John's for 4 years. So I was eating pizza every night and I knew nothing. I knew I was eating McDonald's to gain weight for football season. You know, I grew up completely not any natural medicine, no family with natural medicine. So for me to get to this point, it's because it has a potential huge upside in the new experience, and there's no downside. There's no downside to breath class or meditation or EFT. It's just an experience.
Yeah.
You know, it doesn't cost you anything except some time and knowledge.
As long as you choose your therapist wisely. Like, so again, like when you walk into your hypno, if you haven't met this person before and this person starts talking and your gut's like, get out of here. Mm-hmm. You freaking listen to your gut, right? Your body knows who is safe for you to work with. Your body knows who is skilled enough for you to work with, who is, you know, so again, bringing that, you know, you're not just like, okay, well, I'll just go do whatever now and open myself up to, no, there's toxic people. There's unhealthy people who are working as therapists. There's mm-hmm. people who are well-intentioned, but they don't have the skill level to mm-hmm. handle when the trauma comes up. Mm-hmm. Don't work with those people. Look for the person who ticks all those boxes. So you don't leave your brain and your conscious intellectual mind behind. You bring it and you find that therapist and you find that therapy and you find that space. And then you say to your conscious critical mind, you say, okay, now I'm going to have an experience. So I need you to go sit in the back there. Yep. You can watch, but don't get in here. And when we're done, you can come back in and we can unpack this.
Amazing.
And that's a great way for, you know, anybody who's like critical or skeptical to allow themselves to have a deeper experience. But also honor that intellectual mind, that critical, cynical, skeptical mind, which is very valuable. We don't want to like get rid of that. That's part of what makes us powerful. But we want to say to, okay, you go over there. That's what I do. I say, go sit down over there. You watch everything, right? Yep. You're not going to miss anything that happens here. You watch, you take notes, you do whatever you need to do for us. And when we're done, you can come back in and then we're going to go through all this. But
that's an amazing way of seeing it. Cause I'm an overanalyzer, and most people who are really successful in life tend to be an overanalyzers, and they'd like to control everything. And some of these things, you just let it go. Don't try to analyze it. Don't try to make sense of it. Just do it. Have the experience, because the experience is...
And you'll be in your hypnotherapy. You'll be... And then that your little guy sitting in the back there will go, you're just making this shit up. And you go, well, this is you. Then you have a little talk with it. You go, well, you know what? If I'm making up this story and not some other, maybe there's a reason for that. So go sit down and go back to watching. And you literally, that's how you dialogue with that part of your brain, so that you can then be free to actually experience, like pure experience.
Yeah.
So
you gotta be bold, and you gotta be bold. I love that, because I always thought it takes a bold person to do something like this. So be bold, because it can't hurt. So thanks, Jini. The last thing I just wanted to wrap up for one of my clients who had that, did the sigmoidoscopy, had the blood coming back. You know, we've been working on using the comfrey root enema and you know, a little bit of bentonite clay to try to clog things up and heal that mucosal. She's going back to the elemental. Do you feel that doing large dose of the retention enema would also be relevant with the comfrey? Can those two be combined into the same?
I don't think I would put comfrey with probiotics, because the comfrey may have an effect on the bacteria. Mm-hmm. We don't know. Like, what if it has an antibiotic component to it? Mm-hmm. Right? Then you're just, I would separate them by 2 hours.
Okay. Two hours. Okay.
Yeah. Yeah.
Okay. So maybe they could do one at 9 or 8 p.m. then 10 p.m.
Yeah. Or one in the morning and one at night, like whatever works out for their bowel. But I would just put them or one on one day and then the other on the other day.
Okay. Okay. So yeah. And then, cause I wouldn't want them to affect each other too much, but, that's great. I think that's amazing. I mean, we hit some big points here with, you know, antimicrobials, some more on probiotics, how to start healing a fistula and how to potentially heal that fistula correctly before just trying to do wound healing.
Yeah.
And, you know, potentials of hemorrheal and using EFT or breath to start healing the trauma of dis-ease. And, you know, and also about strictures and, starting to heal those. So, I think we hit a lot, basically everything I wanted to talk about, and, anyone who listens, I think they're gonna get a lot out of this.
Yes, and, definitely.
You know, if you guys are watching from my YouTube channel, Jini Patel is at listentoyourgut.com. She's got a ton of different eBooks and all these little points we just talked about. You can go to her blog and then search for the colonoscopy, search for the fissure. The eBooks will be in there. And then you can also go to her shop for a organic, clean, certified source of DMSO or comfrey root or wild olive oregano. I still use Joy of the Mountains. I'm using the DMSO you recommended. Usually if I'm not sure which product, I usually just use the one you recommend because it's easy. And anyone out there, if it's an extra 10 or 15 bucks, we spend that in 2 days at Starbucks. You know, it's really worth getting a clean product that's going to do the job right and not wasting our time.
Or even just go to the shop and see which brand I'm recommending and then buy that locally. Like, that's the other thing I tell people. If you don't want to buy online or if it doesn't work for you, that's not a problem. But use that as the brand product resource list to make sure you're getting that same level of quality and efficacy.
Mm-hmm. Okay. I agree. That's all the questions I had for you today. Right. And so thanks so much, Jini. You're amazing. And
thanks, Dane.
Thank you for doing everything.
Yeah. Thank you for being there on the front line helping all these people. That's awesome.
Amen. A lot of good things coming out.
Yeah. All right, sweetie.
All right. See you, Jini. Bye.
Take care.